everybody, and welcome to episode 1.9 of You're Off the Case, the Ottawa Hockey Podcast. I'm Clayton Johns alongside Jamie Shinkuski as we try to cover the past week of hockey here in the nation's capital. And Jamie, this week, we start with the Ottawa Senators.
Yes, this week, just like every other week, we start with the Ottawa Senators, who had three games starting Friday, March 2nd, at home to the Blackhawks in a 2-1 loss. Milan Mihalik, with his 29th of the season, scored the only goal for the Sens. And on that goal, Matt Gilroy notched an assist, which was his first point as a Senator. Former Sen Marian Hossa scored the game winner for the Hawks halfway through the second period, and Robin Lehner, making his third consecutive start, made 37 saves as the Senators got outshot 39-26. Sunday, March 4th, they were in Florida, where they lost 4-2 to the Panthers. Jared Cowan, with his 5th of the season, and Chris Neal, with his 11th, had the goals in that one. Robin Lehner making 24 saves in the loss. Tuesday, March 6th, they got back in the win column in Tampa in a 7-3 victory. Big Ben Bishop got his first start as a Sen, making 25 saves in the victory. Mihalik, with 3 goals and an assist, led the way for the Sens, and he passed the 30-goal mark for the first time in his career. His previous season high was 26 goals. Colin Greening recorded his first career Gordie Howe hat-trick with a goal and an assist in a fight against Keith Ollie. Kyle Turris, Sergei Gonchar, and Erik Karlsson rounded out the scoring for the Sens. Ottawa has 14 games left on their schedule, including 3 this week at home against the Rangers and the Sabres. And Wednesday night, they go to Montreal to face the lowly Montreal Canadiens, who are currently last place in the East. This week, the Senators are still sitting 7th in the Eastern Conference, 1 point back of New Jersey, who does hold 2 games in hand. Moving on to the rest of NHL, superstar Sidney Crosby has been cleared for contact and may return to gameplay soon. He was recently voted by other players in the NHL as the best player in the league. Now, the Pens have won 7 games in a row, and Clayton, with the addition of Crosby to their lineup, do you think that they become a favorite to win the Stanley Cup?
Well, adding Sidney Crosby to any lineup certainly doesn't hurt, and it definitely doesn't hurt this Penguins team that has won 7 games in a row. This line of James Neal, Evgeny Malkin, and Chris Kunitz is clicking right now really well, so throw Sidney Crosby into a mix, perhaps throw him in a line with Pascal Dupuis. Even though he's regularly played with Kunitz, I don't think you can count the Penguins out ever, but I think this just makes them even stronger heading into the playoffs, especially in the Eastern Conference.
And last week, Clayton said that he thought Ron Wilson needed to be fired, and that indeed was what happened. He has been replaced by former Ducks coach Randy Carlyle. Funny that Burke hires Carlyle again, but they did win a cup together back in 07 with the Ducks. The Leafs are now in 12th place in the Eastern Conference, 5 points out of a playoff spot, but they only have 2 wins in their last 14 games. Now we're coming down to the final games of the NHL season. In the West Coast, it's very tight. From 7th to 11th, only 5 points separates those teams. And in the Eastern Conference, the Jets are holding down the last playoff spot in their first season in Winnipeg, but only 7 points separates them from 14th place.
The Eastern Conference in the National Hockey League is certainly a tight one, and not any different in the Ontario Hockey League in both conferences, but for now we'll focus on the Ottawa 67s and their bid to win the Eastern Conference regular season championship. They continued on with that Friday, March the 2nd in Sarnia, their first game as part of a Western road swing. They defeated the Sting 3-1. Shane Prince scored his 40th goal of the season and had an assist, and Peter Mrazek got the win for the 67s as he beat the Sting for the second time this season. Saturday, March the 3rd, the 67s traveled to the John Labatt Center to take on the London Knights, and the 67s came out with a 2-1 victory to avenge the loss the previous weekend at home against the Knights. Tyler Toffoli scored for the 67s. Cody Ceci had the game winner as Peter Mrazek got the win for the second night in a row. Overage defenseman Brett Cook had the lone goal for the Knights. Sunday, March 4th, the Ottawa 67s were at the Sleeman Center in Guelph to take on the Storm. They lost 4-3 in a shootout. They were down 3-1 heading into the third period before Tyler Toffoli added his 48th goal of the year and Stephen Jane scored to even the game at 3 goals apiece. But the 67s couldn't solve Garrett Sparks in the shootout, and Jason Dickinson scored the shootout winner for the Storm. They're back in action on Wednesday night in Kingston to take on the Frontenacs. They defeated them easily 5-1. Tyler Toffoli with a goal and two assists. His three-point night gives him back the scoring lead in the Ontario Hockey League from Michael Scarboscia of the Sudbury Wolves. Mike Cazzola had a pair of assists, and Shane Prince did not dress for the second consecutive game, but has posted on his Twitter account that his injury is not serious, as he is expected to return to the lineup on Friday against the Niagara Ice Dogs. Pair of games this weekend for the 67s, Friday night against the Niagara Ice Dogs, and Sunday afternoon at the J. Benson Carden Center against the Mississauga St. Michael's Majors. Moving along now to the CCHL and the Ottawa Junior Senators, who had the final three games of their regular season over the past week, starting Friday, March 2nd, against the Brockville Braves, the first of a home-and-home series with Brockville. Devin Rice and Ben Robillard led the Junior Sens to a 2-0 victory. Connor Brown had a pair of assists, and Ed Zadolchik got his third shutout of the season. Saturday, March the 3rd, they were at home to take on the Braves in the second game. They got this win 3-0. Kevin Ryder and Thierry Gibault scored the goals before Connor Brown added an empty net goal for the Junior Sens, and Charlie Millen picked up his first shutout of the season. Wednesday, March 7th, in the final game of the year for the Junior Sens, they were at home against the Pembroke Lumber Kings, defeating them 5-1. Ben Robillard had a pair of goals in the victory, and now the Junior Sens have set up a first-round playoff match with the Cornwall Colts. This past week's game of the week was between the Cornwall Colts and the Kanata Stallions on Tuesday, March the 6th, and Kanata edged out a upset 6-5 shootout victory over the Colts, getting 5 goals from 5 different players, while Tyler Spink had 2 goals and an assist in the loss for Cornwall. Try to give you an idea of the CCHL playoff picture with 1 weekend left in the season. The only set matchup is between the Cornwall Colts and the Ottawa Junior Senators, the 2-7 matchup. The Nepean Raiders have locked up the first spot and will play either the Smiths Falls Bears or the Kanata Stallions. In order for them to play Kanata would have to win each of their 2 remaining games, while Smiths Falls would have to lose both of theirs. Those two teams play each other once more. The Carleton Place Canadiens and Brockville Braves are still eligible each to win the third position. They will finish either third or fourth. The third seed will play the Pembroke Lumber Kings, and the fourth seed will play the Hawkesbury Hawks. Moving along to the OUA and the CIS, just a couple of quick notes. The Carleton Ravens had a couple of players earn some honors over the past week. Brandon McLean, the team's captain, was named to the OUA's first All-Star team. He finished 5th in league scoring with 40 points. McLean is the Carleton Ravens' all-time assist leader with 96 over his 4-year career at the Ottawa School. And McLean has now signed a contract with the Florida Everblades of the East Coast Hockey League to move on to the professional portion of his career. And rookie defenseman Matt Stanish was named to the OUA's first all-rookie team, and Jamie head coach Marty Johnson has called him a building block for the program, and as we saw over the year, that's certainly what Stanish was on the blue line for the Ravens.
Yes, Matt Stanish has definitely shown his capabilities this season, quarterbacking the power play, playing out on the penalty kill. He's been playing all kinds of minutes, and he still has 3 years of eligibility left with the Ravens moving forward. He demonstrated what he was capable with last year, helping the Owen Sound attack to an OHL league title, and he continued that this season with the Ravens, and he will be a good key player moving forward.
Ravens definitely have a solid defenseman in Matthew Stanish. Moving along to the Ottawa Gigis, who also received a couple of accolades over the past week. Captain Matthew Mathaw, the former Ottawa 67, was named the OUA Eastern Division's most sportsmanlike player. Goaltender Russell Abbott and forward Alexandre Touchette were named to the OUA Eastern Division's all-rookie team. Moving along now to the regular segment portion of our program, and this week, as usual, we start with the name of the week.
This is our first ever fan request coming from @J_Willie24, one of our Twitter followers, who pointed to the QMJHL, and in 38 games played, he has 1 goal and 4 assists, and is a beautiful -6 from Val d'Or, Quebec, number 24 on the PEI Rockets roster. Our name of the week, Deverick Otterize.
Jamie, I actually have nothing to say about that name. We have not had any animal parts, body parts in our names yet, but that's a first. Moving on to a new segment that we debuted last week, What happened there?
This time we look back to the last draft of the 20th century, 1999, and we are looking at a draft bust. The man who was picked before both reigning Art Ross Trophy winners, the Sedin Twins, Atlanta Thrashers selected first overall, Patrick Steffen. Now, to shed some light on why he is a draft bust, second and third overall picks, the Sedins, have both played over 850 games and both have over 700 points and each have a league scoring title to their name, while Steffen played 455 games and only recorded 188 points. He's most famous for his missed empty net against the Edmonton Oilers, where he bobbled the puck and fell into the corner, allowing the Oilers to go back down the ice and tie it up. Yes, Patrick Steffen, you were definitely a draft bust. What happened there?
Patrick Steffen, that was definitely one of the worst moments I've seen in empty net history, if you will. And what happened there? We can ask that same question with this week's You're Off the Case moment of the week. But Jamie, we had a couple of different options this week. Could have gone with Ron Wilson being fired from the Toronto Maple Leafs. Last Thursday night, Ed Jovanovski knocked Scott Clemenson out of the net to allow a goal against the Winnipeg Jets in a 7-0 loss for the Florida Panthers. Could point to the Erie Otters and Sherry Basson for their miscue in goaltending last Sunday against the Niagara Ice Dogs. But we're going to have to go with Devin Setoguchi of the Minnesota Wild after he fell in the shootout against the Montreal Canadiens after he scored the game-tying goal in the third period to send the game to overtime. But his fall in the shootout gave Montreal the 5-4 victory.
Yes, Paul Bissonnette was quoted on Twitter as saying that he doesn't remember giving Setoguchi permission to use his own shootout move. And I have to say, Devin Setoguchi tried his best, but could not quite come out with pulling off a Dennis Wideman. But all the same, Devin Setoguchi, just like Sergei Bobrovsky, you're off the case. Anyway, folks, that's all the time we have for this week. We'll be coming back to you approximately same time from the same place in 1 week from now.
Thank you for tuning in, everybody, to episode 1.9 of You're Off the Case, the Ottawa Hockey Podcast. For Jamie Shinkuski, I'm Clayton Johns for this week, ending in March the 9th, 2012. If I had it all again, I'd change it all.